Du bist keine Stadt, eigentlich bist du ein Museum. Dein Ruf ereilt dir nach und nicht voraus. Du hast die Flexibilität von meinem Fließbandgerät und manchmal hält man das ja eigentlich kaum aus. Aber mir geht's da so wie jedem echten Wiener. Und mit den Jahren lernt man vieles zu verzeihen. Wenn in der U-Bahn einer lauthals in sein Handy schimpft, dann weiß ich ja, hier bin ich daheim. Wien, nur du allein darfst zu mir so goschert und grantig sein, weil du bist jedem guten Ratschlag stets erhaben. Deine Arroganz ist nüchtern selten zu ertragen und trotzdem bist du mir ein echter Freund und ich zieh vor dir meinen Hut, weil du bist vollkommen out, aber du stehst dazu. Ja, wie der letzte Kaiser bist du.
Geht den Wienern einmal blöder, weiß der Treibstoff aus, wären's rabiat, denn ohne Wein trocknet man aus. Dort beim Wirten zum Verschierten brennt ein Lamperl, geh mal rein. Wann er zusperrt, sind wir bös und gehen nach Haus.
Ständig leichte Unzufriedenheit, weil uns der Alltag nimmer gefreut. Wir nehmen uns die Zeit zum Ranzen.
Der Grund dafür erschließt sich nicht, weil diese Stadt doch für sich spricht. Sie ist eh so leer, und hier komm, geh mal tanzen.
Wien, nur du allein darfst zu mir so goschert und grantig sein, weil du bist jeden guten Ratschlag stets erhaben. Deine Arroganz ist nüchtern selten zu ertragen und trotzdem bist du mir ein echter Freund und ich zieh vor dir meinen Hut, weil du bist vollkommen out, aber du stehst dazu. Ja, Wien, der letzte Kaiser bist du. Bis zu dem Tag, an dem deine Fiakern immer fahren und die Geigen immer wohl zerspülen zum nächsten Jahr. Bis das der letzte Würstler schließt und ein Kebabstandl wird und sich der Sacker für dein Kacker flächendeckend etabliert. Weil ich dich kenn, weiß ich, das erleb ich nimmer, weil es ist quasi für immer. Wien, nur du allein darfst zu mir so goschert und grantig sein, weil du bist jedem guten Ratschlag stets erhaben. Deine Arroganz ist nüchtern selten zu ertragen und trotzdem bist du mir ein echter Freund und ich zieh vor dir meinen Hut, weil du bist zwar ständig besoffen, aber stehst dazu. Ja, Wien, der letzte Kaiser bist du. Oh, Wien, der letzte Kaiser bist du.
So, Max, thank you very much for talking to us. And I know that one of the reasons that we have everybody here is because Glenn is also very interested in knowing, he's learning about his own family as he studies his father's experience that he was unaware of, his Jewish background and what life was like in pre-war Vienna. And so we'll start there. And I know you cover this in other oral histories and in your book. But what do you remember, what stands out in your memories of life in Vienna prior to the Nazi takeover?
We were very comfortable. We had a very nice apartment, a very large apartment, which was decorated by Feuer. Now, I don't know who Feuer was, but he must have been the decorator in Vienna, because for the rest of her life, my mother complained that she had an apartment decorated by Feuer. Mm-hmm. And that's what she had to give up because of the Nazis.
And I want to come back to that because I think it touches on some of these questions of identity that I want to explore. But as you think, you talk a lot about your schooling, the in a way it's the you went to the elite school in
the elite school indeed.
In Vienna,
and it took us took me a major effort to get into it.
Mm-hmm.
When I was 9 and a half, when I had finished, the system in Vienna was this way. Everybody went to school for 4 years, public school, from 6 to 10, or 6 to 9 and a half, or whatever it was. Then you had a great divide. You either went to continued public school for 4 more years and then stopped at 14, you entered the workforce, or you passed an exam that would allow you to go to a gymnasium for the next 8 years and then into the university system. But not only did you have to pass an exam, but your parents had to be able to afford the cost.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a major divide there. My parents were, and then you applied for to different schools, a gymnasium, a real gymnasium, which was were engineers who, and where you were taught Latin, where you were taught French and English,
mm-hmm.
Or an academic gymnasium, of which there was only one, which had been in existence for 200 years.
Mm-hmm.
And the building in which it was is Beethovenplatz number 1 along the Ring,
mm-hmm.
Where they've been since 1865 and they're still there. That was my school,
mm-hmm.
and I worked like a Dickens to prepare for the exam. There was a written exam, and if you passed it, there was an oral exam with 3 professors firing questions at you.
Mm-hmm. And then this is when you were approximately 9 and a half.
Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. then they put out a list on the mm-hmm. school door of people who had passed it. And if you hadn't passed it, you had to go to the popular school, the Volksschule,
mm-hmm.
for a year with all the poor people,
mm-hmm.
and then apply again.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a crucial test, and I still have nightmares about it.
So to what extent was that, it clearly was tied to status, but getting in was a big deal.
My parents, of course, wanted me to be a doctor, because what else did you want for your children when you were in Vienna at that time? I would have made a terrible doctor. Anyway, but I was taught Latin and Greek. They were the two most important courses,
mm-hmm.
5 days a week. Latin, 3 days a week, Greek.
Mm-hmm.
It did me some good in picking up other languages, mm-hmm. but it would have been a lot better if I had learned English and French
mm-hmm.
in school instead of coming to Paris in 1938 without any language mm-hmm. knowledge of modern languages, except for a little Hebrew.
Mm-hmm. Did the school form a social circle? In other words, did the parents of the students socialize, or was it not that kind of structure?
It was not that kind of school, but there is more to that story. You're touching a sore subject. My parents were Galicianas.
Mm-hmm.
They came from a despised section of Poland, Ukraine, Slovakia,
mm-hmm.
from a little shtetl, from a fiddler in the roof shtetl.
Mm-hmm.
The parents of my schoolmates were university educated, upper middle class mm-hmm. people.
And some probably
they
from
were
very old families, very with titles.
Mm-hmm. Some of them. although there was a division of the 40% of the Akademische Gymnasium student body was Jewish and 40%. Was expelled. Mm-hmm.
So that was we'll talk
about. I looked down upon my parents to my shame for not speaking, not being able to talk about Goethe and Schiller and Shakespeare in the Schlegel Antique translation. Mm-hmm. My father was a student, and he could conduct a service by heart. Mm-hmm. He was, but I didn't appreciate his Jewishness. But our classes were divided. There was a 1A and 1B class, 2A, 2B. The B classes were always all Jewish. Not only was it 40%, but 3 hours a week we had religious instruction, either a priest or a rabbi.
Rabbi. And I know there's a story behind this. We'll hold off on that one for a minute, but I want to try to push you a little more to think about the notion of community that your parents had, because
my
as you say,
they were members of a Stiebel, a small synagogue, where their friends were members too.
Mm-hmm. And that was that the social circle that you recall being involved with?
I was not involved in that. I was involved only with my schoolmates. With that, there was so little time for anything else. School was 6 days a week, from 8 in the morning until 1. Mm-hmm. Then we came home and had a big meal of the day. My father, when he was not traveling, was there. He had a big meal of the day around 1:30, 2 o'clock. After that, I had to spend the afternoon doing homework, and we had a sandwich and went to bed.
Mm-hmm. Wow. So
without television.
And without cell phones.
And without radio.
Without radio. And maybe, did you subscribe to newspapers? Did your father subscribe to newspapers?
I don't think he did.
Hmm. And so, do you recall any kind of social events, or was the week around the events that happened at the synagogue?
The Jewish holidays, Passover was a very big deal. And he had the two seders. Mm-hmm. And my grandparents, while they were still alive, were there. Mm-hmm. And my sister and I stole the Afikoimen.
Mm-hmm. Do you recall what you got for finding it? Was there a?
Probably a book.
A book?
I was a voracious reader even then.
Mm-hmm. And so, were you reading at the time in German and Latin?
No, for entertainment, I was reading German.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What do you call reading for entertainment?
Karl May, for books. Mm-hmm. Do you know about Karl May?
Karl May? No, I'm not trying
Karl May was Hitler's favorite author, which I didn't know at the time. He was an author. He wrote his books in the late 19th century, and they were books about his adventures, fictional.
Mm-hmm.
His adventures either in the Wild West with Winnetou, the chief of the Apaches, as his friend, or in Araby. It's where his sidekick was Carabinensi.
Go ahead.
And these books were the devoted reading of all German-speaking kids, boys. Mm-hmm. They were all for boys. And they were wonderful. And two of them have been translated, and I got one crucial book and let my grandchildren read it. the male grandchildren, and they loved it.
So
and Karl May, who the author, apparently was never outside of the Germany. He wrote about all these travel stories and adventures with a Superman kind of hero who could hit somebody and make him insensitive to anything else immediately. And Karl May, apparently, when he got rich from his writing, finally went to the United States and supposedly was turned around and went right back. He said, it's the way I described it anyway. That's an apocryphal story.
So that's...
incidentally, Karl May books are still being bought, and if you go to Germany and go to a large bookstore, if they still have any left, there's always a corner with Karl May books.
I will have to take a look at that. So Karl May, it's a Hungarian name, right?
No, it's M-A-I.
Oh, okay. So that clearly had a lot to do with your perceptions of what the United States was.
Very much so.
So, well, I want to return to that, but not. I don't want to jump too far forward yet. But I think that's really fascinating. So your life was very much around books, and your parents' life seemed to be both revolving around their community within the Jewish community and the business that your father ran. Did your mother also work for? Did she work with your father or no?
No.
Okay. And
not until after we left Vienna, then
whatever necessity.
But I remember I was a child, and my life was my school.
Right. And do you remember having particular friends that were not Jewish? When you were
I had no friends who were not Jewish.
You had no friends who were not Jewish. Mm-hmm. Okay. And was that something that was because
I
was
had
that
no
a choice?
Occasion to meet them in public school during from the age of 6 to 10? Like I told you, the first 4 years, the classes were mixed. There were non-Jews and Jews. Everybody had to go to school.
But at the academies at the gymnasium, they were not mixed.
No, they were separated.
And do you think that even though you explain that as tied to a religious instruction, and that's the reason there was separation, do you think that aggravated religious tensions that by
Vienna was always very anti-Semitic.
Can you tell us a little bit about that environment?
You should read a book called Stadt ohne Juden, The City Without Jews. Have you read it?
Yes, and we talked about that once before.
Yes.
Yeah. But if we think about what do you think were the reasons for that anti-Semitism? Why was Vienna, which was a very cosmopolitan city, why was it so anti-Semitic?
It wasn't any more anti-Semitic in my view than any other city, London and Paris. Somewhere, Prague was possibly a little less anti-Semitic. But to make up for that, Slovakia was very anti-Semitic. Poland, of course, was anti-Semitic.
So when you talk about that anti-Semitism before the Nazis came, can you give some examples of what you saw?
It was what we lived with.
Well, what kind of examples did you see or did you live? Did you experience?
I did not experience any personally.
Did your parents was their clientele primarily Jewish?
No, my father did business with a lot of non-Jews. I told you what his business was.
Yeah, as a furrier.
Fur dealer. And he did, when he bought from non-Jews who were the local hunters and the local dealers in the small towns and villages of the Carpathian Mountains.
And he spoke German and Yiddish and Hebrew, Czech.
He spoke several, Ukrainian, Russian, and Polish. I never appreciated how smart my father was.
And what do you remember him, what kind of lessons did he tell you? Obviously, your parents wanted you to be a doctor, but how did they explain that to you? Why was that important? That you be a doctor.
Status.
And did they believe that that gave you status in a broad sense among the non-Jewish community as well, or?
That I cannot answer. My parents did not talk too much to, there were no general discussions, which I had when my children grew up.
And how about with your sister? I mean, I know she's younger, so.
She's 4 years younger. She was. She passed away very young.
Okay, so what do you recall extended family visits? I know you write about when you get to 1938 and to the Anschluss, the experience that your family had. You make a comment about just how many conversations must have been happening similarly among other families about what do we do? Do we leave? Or do we stay because of possessions, because of...
Well, my parents, I never gave them enough credit for the decision they made to leave.
Yeah, that must have been an incredibly hard decision to make. And so what do you think, do you recall any conversations
not
about why?
With me.
You do write about how you and Jewish students and a couple of the Jewish professors were forced to scrub the streets, and that you came home bloodied, and that had a traumatic effect on your parents.
Yes.
You said you don't know if that was the breaking point or if there were other things that were happening that...
Well, I know one other significant thing was when the superintendent of the building in which my father, in which we had the apartment and my father's warehouse, and said to my father, here's a proposition. If you give me your business, you can continue to run it and we'll share the profits. And that way it'll be an Aryan business and they won't take it away from me. And my father said, that's a good thought, I'll think about it. And then I think that may have been the triggering us.
Do you recall your grandparents visiting anyone?
My grandparents were dead at the time we left.
Okay.
Which was...
Right, you said the last one died in 37.
That's right.
Okay, so do you recall any other family, extended family?
Yes, we had my uncle, Hertz. There's a story about him. Did I mention?
And so do you recall them having any conversations with your parents about the worsening political situation?
I'm sure they must have had, but I can't recall.
Understand.
Think of me, I was 13 and a half.
Oh, I know. I'm just, I'm hoping that there's something that might come to you, but if I can't remember what I was doing when I was 13 and a half. So just trying to ask questions in the hopes that we turn something up.
So, I remember when we left, we had one suitcase each and I filled mine with books. And when we left for Paris, my parents had beautiful gobelins on the walls, And I said, can I scratch them? Can I destroy them? Should I do that? And my parents wouldn't let me do anything mm-hmm. damage.
That's a really interesting thought, because it indicates to some extent that you did not see the possibility of return.
I did not.
You did not.
So
you,
they did.
Do you recall discussions with your parents about how they thought about what they were doing?
We got to Paris on the 21st of May, 1938. I think until Kristallnacht, which was in November of that year, my parents still were hoping that there would be some kind of pressure on Hitler to calm his followers about instead it increased, culminating in Kristallnacht. Mm-hmm. We were, by that time, I know everybody that we all knew that there would be a war, that there would be a, but we were safe in Paris. France had the largest army in Europe and the Maginot Line. Mm-hmm. So we were safe. But we knew we wouldn't be able to go back to Vienna until after there was a war. Mm-hmm. And of course, in a war, you know.
So I'm interested in, and I know you've talked about this in multiple venues, but the difference between how a teenager thinks about becoming a refugee versus how a parent thinks about becoming a refugee. And so, as you were saying, for you thought, we're leaving. Your parents thought, we'll come back, and we'll be back. You mentioned in the book that your father said, used a term about returning that he did not commonly use. I think you said he said Friday, right?
I'm sorry?
He said, someone asked him if he will return, and he said Freilich, right? When he can freely return, as opposed to, I don't know, just a simple answer of yes or no. And so what did that mean in your mind when he said it that way?
Well, that was when we crossed the German border into France, mm-hmm. and the policeman of border guard said, and are you planning to return? And my father said, freilich, which doesn't mean freely. It just means yes. But it was not a word that was usually.
Okay. Why do you think he used it?
He wanted to sound Germanic. It's more of a German than an Austrian word.
I see. Okay. Now, before we kind of move on to...
Just to follow up a little, I took the forms for the American visa application, and I argued with my parents to fill them out. They weren't interested. Mm-hmm. So I take credit for that.
Yes, as you should. Mm-hmm. And before we kind of move on to your experience in France, how do you think your experience as a student at the Academische Gymnasium actually shaped you? How did it affect who you thought you were?
It taught me how important it was to pass tests.
Okay. Did it also shape your view of difference? I mean, because of the way you were segregated?
Because we were born different. And I must say, there were times when I was sorry I was a Jew, because then if I had not been a Jew, I could have been a Hitler Jugend leader. Mm-hmm. I would have been a good Nazi.
Did you see the appeal of that? Or
very much so.
Can you describe that?
Uniforms, marching. Fighting for your country. It was my country.
And I want to return to that sentiment.
That's why when I came to the United States, this became my country. And I think you'll find that when you speak to other refugees like me, they are more patriotic Americans than anybody born here.
And I do want to talk about that, I want to first have you discuss your experience in France and potentially why you didn't feel that way, or if you did feel that way initially about France,
never occurred to me that we would stay in France.
Did it occur to your parents?
I doubt it.
Well, you talk about your mother very brief, having this quick
breakdown
about not wanting to
when
leave.
We were ready to board the ship. She had been a tower of strength. She had taken care of us. She had made sure that we had enough to eat, even if it was a sardine sandwich in the hotel room, but she made sure.
But
it was not what she deserved. She had been a lady in Vienna.
And so the...
And then she said, who goes to America? Gangsters.
I'm sorry.
Goes to America, she says. Nah. It's full of gangsters.
Right. You said gangsters and people who can't make it in Europe. Right.
So
to some extent, again, this her idea or her sense of self that was very class oriented, very status oriented.
Absolutely.
And... But you had a different conception, even though you had been raised in a way, especially in the elite of the elite, going to the academic gymnasium.
Yes, so, but I wanted to be an American.
Because of what you read?
I had read English. I would have liked to be either an American or English.
And when you, but what was the reason you think that your parents did not say we should be French?
I don't think that France would have been acceptable. I think the French were not welcoming immigrants like Americans do. I think we would have been outsiders all the time if we had lived in France. Whereas when we came here, never mind accents and language difficulties, this is a country of immigrants.
And do you feel that so you knew your time in France, you were a refugee?
We were outsiders and we needed documents and laissez-passer and sauf-conduits and all. And we had a number of experiences where we were standing in line in front of a podium where somebody sits who has got no education and no information about the world, but he's got the stamp, and he makes us jump through hoops till we get that stamp.
And did you not experience that with the United States?
No.
From and the moment even the army?
No. The army was different, but when we landed, one of the most remarkable things was we landed in Brooklyn on the SS Nyasa, the Portuguese ship. And immigration people came on board and set up a system of standing in line to show our passports and a visa and so forth. Mm-hmm. And they were polite. They said, Mister. They spoke English, which I didn't know. Mm-hmm. But they could tell that they were courteous to the people in front of us and to us. Mm-hmm. And that was very different.
Mm-hmm. You described France, at least, as being both anti-Semitic and xenophobic. So to what extent was this something that was...
At the same time, there were French people who were wonderful to us.
Yes, you talk about the and in many cases, there's always that ambivalence, right? There's always both or multiple sides. But in the case of what you experienced in France, to what extent do you think that that was primarily xenophobic or primarily anti-Semitic?
I'm inclined to think it was xenophobic, if you have to make a choice between the two.
More fear of just any outsider. Mm-hmm. Okay. Do you recall, as you were now a teenager in France, do you recall any discussions with your parents of the nature of your belonging in France, whether they felt some degree of acceptance, or they felt as outsiders, or they felt temporary?
You have to distinguish between France before the defeat and France after the defeat.
Mm-hmm. So first, we'll start
the defeat,
before.
We were hoping that the French and British would defeat the Germans, and my parents, I suspect, were planning to return to Vienna as soon as that was the case. I didn't discuss it, but we were hoping that the war would come to a glorious end quickly, and we would return. Once the defeat happened, we lived in Vichy, France, and anti-Semitism became the law. And we were under constant pressure and fear. And then we started to concentrate on getting out.
Mm-hmm.
And getting out was as complicated as getting in somewhere.
Mm-hmm. Right, because in order to get out, you had to get into numerous other places before you were out.
Yes.
Yes. So as you thought about that, you had to go through Spain, you had to go through Portugal.
Well, when we reached Nice after the 6 weeks on the road, mm-hmm. escaping from Paris, when we reached Nice, mm-hmm. we were in this following position. We had an expiring permit to stay in France that had to be renewed. We had to have an American visa, for which we had to have a quota number and an affidavit from an American citizen that would take care of us in case we couldn't make it on our own, so we wouldn't be a burden on the public purse. We had to have a transit visa for Spain, which we couldn't get on our Czech passports because Czechoslovakia didn't exist. We had to have a transit visa in Portugal, and we had to have ship tickets.
Mm-hmm.
And we did it all miraculously.
Mm-hmm. And
and we had to have a French exit visa showing that all our taxes were paid.
Mm-hmm. And most of that was required by the United States, right? That most of that were...
The only thing that was required by the United States was the affidavit and the quota number. The quota number, which was based on when we applied, and on my father's birthplace, which turned out to be Czechoslovakia. Of course, he was born in Austria-Hungary, in the Habsburg Empire.
Right, and then you've written about the story of how you got the Czech passports, and then in what I'm most interested in is you tell the story of how you went to, you as a child kind of snuck into the office where the Spanish diplomats
that was in, were. In 1940, and they crossed out, I have it on the passport, my passport, which I gave to the museum. I still have my parents.
Mm-hmm. Right, with an X.
Out.
And so do you recall how that made you feel?
Oh God, I was so enthusiastic that I had flirted with this girl in the hotel and she let me in and I sneaked into the room where there were this big table like this.
And they were stamping the passports.
And they were writing into them and I snuck my four passports into the list. Mm-hmm. And I saw them writing into them and then they came around the table. And I see the consul, instead of signing it, crossing it out. That there is no more Czechoslovakia.
Mm-hmm. And you heard him say that? Or
yes.
In French or in Spanish? Or
I don't know what he spoke, but I understood it.
Mm-hmm. And when you saw that and when you think about that,
it
how does
broke
that
my
make?
Heart. Mm-hmm. I took the passports back and then I had to hitchhike to Saint-Jean-de-Luz, where the family was from Bayonne. Mm-hmm. And I got a very nice guy to give me a ride, and on the way we saw British ships being strafed by German pilot.
Yeah,
planes.
You told me that story. So I'm very interested in the kind of the feeling or the experience of being
terrible.
Stateless.
I felt terrible. Mm-hmm. I had to promise my father. I was there with my father, and I started to flirt with this girl from the hotel.
Mm-hmm.
I was probably better looking than I was now. I was 16 and a half.
And you were already quite tall.
I was tall.
Mm-hmm. And so the story is...
Anyway, I told my father, go home to Saint-Jean-de-Luz. There was a bus. He took the bus and leave me. Mm-hmm. And I persuaded him to leave me with the four passports. Mm-hmm. How will you get back? He said, don't worry about me. I figured I could hitchhike.
Mm-hmm. And when you were,
and
when
then
you say
I came back, and I was so coming back with the Spanish visa to my parents would have been such a heroic, wonderful victory.
Mm-hmm.
Instead, I came back with my tail between my legs, defeated.
Do you recall your parents' reaction? How did you explain it to them?
I told them what happened.
Mm-hmm. And do you recall their reaction?
They didn't reproach me.
Mm-hmm.
It just was another burden.
Mm-hmm.
Then we made our way to...
So you write about how you, and you just explained how you thought it would be great to go to America. Your mother less so.
I read a lot of books about...
What about your father? Where was he? Did he have a preference of where he wanted to go or stay?
I don't know. We never talked about it.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Even when you went to get the... I mean, it took a while to persuade them to actually fill out the visa application.
That was after we had arrived in Paris.
Mm-hmm.
That took a while.
What was it that allowed you to persuade them? Was it Kristallnacht? Was it...
No, we applied earlier than that. I don't know, I nagged them.
Mm-hmm. Just nagged them. Mm-hmm. Okay. So,
my parents were not intellectuals in the Western sense of the word, and I reproached them for that. The parents, they were not the doctors and lawyers of my schoolmates' parents. Mm-hmm. My father was a successful businessman who had pulled himself out of the shtetl.
And what did he do? And you touch on this, and you talk a little bit about your dealing in black markets. So how did you keep yourself alive and fed during your time in occupied France, or in Vichy?
Chesterfield cigarettes. Mm.
And where did they come from?
Italy.
Ah, okay. So and even though France and Italy were officially at war, they'd be smuggled over the border.
They were not so much at war in the... Mm-hmm.
So they would... So American cigarettes smuggled in through Italy.
I have no idea where they came from, but I know they came from Italy.
Okay.
And I had a bike, and I made some deliveries here and there.
Were there other things that were traded in addition to cigarettes?
There were. I'm sorry, I'm losing words sometimes. Perfumes in grass.
Mm-hmm. So luxury items became currency. Was your father able to obtain them? And do you know anything about the networks?
I don't know anything.
But you were involved in...
One of the things that my parents did, they frequently went to the casino in Nice and tried to follow somebody who is lucky and bet along with him. Mm.
Interesting.
Frequently heard them arguing, I should have gone this, I should have done that. But they tried to make some money. His modest gambling at the casino.
And I told you I was going to ask you this question, but how did that kind of experience, do you think, prepare you to get information? In a way, you're extracting money from someone in a black market, but how do you extract? Did that help you to learn the skills to extract information?
First of all, I could talk to the French people as somebody who knew their experience. And I understood something that I didn't mention in my book, the difference between the communists in France and the Force Française de l'Intérieur, the FFI, who were not necessarily Gaullists, but at least anti-communists, and who were far less organized than the communists. The communists were much better organized.
And being in southern France, were there also links with the former Republicans in Spain that were also involved?
I do not know. I knew very little about the end of the Spanish War
except that it ended.
It ended.
Okay. And the did this experience that you had in France, particularly as itinerant refugees, having to travel and move around a lot, and engaging in things like a black market, which must have been difficult for your mother with her senses of decorum and class. How do you think it changed the way you thought about yourself, or did it change the way you thought about yourself?
Uh, I felt confident about what I was doing, but I missed. I probably realized that only much later. I missed a normal childhood. I missed having friends. For the 3 years I was in France, I didn't have any friends. I had some acquaintances. I never played ball with anybody. I never had a friend that I could just be a friend with until I came to the United States and met some of the people in the Austria Jewish group that I've written about.
See, you, so clearly in addition to kind of the missing of the adolescence and the alienation in that way, did you feel that that also separated you from the rest of French society, from the rest of the...
I was an outsider there and I was an outsider here.
An outsider here?
Yes, except for this group.
And did that prepare you for becoming American, or did that hurt in the process?
No, I was so eager to become an American, being a citizen, being sworn in Hagerstown, Maryland, while I was at Ritchie, was enormously important to me. I had been in the country only for 2.5 years, but I was willing to do anything for this country.
Can you say, why did you feel that way?
Because I had lost the country I was born in. And I despised the Austrians for becoming Nazis so easily.
And so this did... The act of becoming a citizen, did it give you some sense of wholeness or some sense of self?
Absolutely.
And was it something that you did? You were not naturalized alone. You were naturalized with a group of people, correct?
Other soldiers from Camp Ritchie who were in similar positions.
Mm-hmm. And did you talk about this with them? Did they share the same?
I don't know. I don't remember. But it gave me pleasure later on. My parents, of course, we all applied for our first papers the moment we landed. The moment we were in the United States, the first thing we did was apply for citizenship, get the first paper. And then 5 years later, my parents, by that time I had been to war and back, when my parents and sister could become citizens, they had to have a witness, and I was their witness.
And do you feel that they, do you think they felt the same way about citizenship that you do? Did they feel
that? I'm not sure. My mother was, they lived in a 1.5 bedroom apartment on West 99th Street near Riverside Drive. Was not the apartment decorated by fire that they had in Vienna.
Did they ever regain the sort of sense of self and status that...
No.
No?
No.
Did they ever...
My father was able to do enough business to maintain himself until later. But he ran out of money. The last few months of his life, I took care of him. My mother had passed away, and my father was unable to work. So I supported him. And those days, there was no Medicare, remember? I had 3 children by that time, and fortunately, I was able to make enough money to be able to send them to college and then take care of my parents. But there were people who had to make the decision, sending children to school or taking care of their parents.
It was, yes, sadly, that decision still happens today.
It does.
Mm-hmm.
So, do you recall, I know that there's a sense of dislocation, a sense of, in a way, of terror, a feel of being unsafe that you had as a, I'm sure, in France as a refugee, in as you are crossing the Pyrenees, and as you are fleeing to Portugal. But was there also, I know you were young, was there also a sense of adventure? But do you, there was, in addition to feeling...
I think we should finish, and then we can sit down at the table.
Okay, okay. Well, I have lots of questions, so I don't know if how long it will take to finish. But in terms of thinking about the experience of being a refugee, I know that there was obviously terror, there was obviously hunger, there was obviously the lack of safety that you felt. But was there also, for a 14-year-old, 15-year-old boy, a degree of excitement of that you remember? Do you remember some kind of sense of adventure? Or was it just...
No, there was no sense of adventure. There was a sense of fear. And necessity.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that.
It was a matter of necessity, mm-hmm. of survival. No so sense of adventure.
And can you tell us a little bit about getting across Spain, getting through Spain?
When we finally made it, mm-hmm. and I described the stories in my book, getting out of France was a Vichy France, where the official government position was worse than the Nazi position in Germany toward Jews. It was a sense of major relief. Now, Portugal was a dictatorship like Spain, allied to Hitler, so we went, but it was one step removed. And then our concentration was to get on the ship to Niassa. And we ran around Lisbon for 4 weeks until I've described it, my sister overheard somebody talking about the Macher.
Right, and you had the good fortune of actually having a consular official, an American consular official, who really helped you in this
Yes,
process.
He did.
Right.
By putting the visa on a piece of bond paper for each of us that I typed on my father's portable typewriter.
What do you think allowed you to, what was it about you that allowed you to develop relationships with people, even at that young age, that won their support?
I don't know. I tried to speak French to the French and English. I learned to read. I could read English books, but I couldn't speak it.
Do you find
did I tell you my obvious story?
Your obvious story?
I'll tell you a story that my wife loves.
Okay.
When I met somebody from this Austrian Jewish group, and she told me that Friday night is where we meet in the ping pong place on 96th Street. I dressed up, I spoke very little English, but everybody there spoke German. I dressed up, I was 16 and a half, and there would be women as well as boys. And I went there, and I was met, and I met some people that I had known in Vienna, and I met some people. And I was talking to somebody, and very debonair, when I said something was perfectly obvious.
That was perfectly?
Obvious.
Okay.
Obviously, obvious is not pronounced obvious. Yes.
Understood.
And I found out that it was obviously not pronounced obviously. And that was one of the more embarrassing moments of my life.
Well, if that's one of the embarrassing moments of your life, then you are a lucky man.
Lenore, who was a college professor in English, loves that story.
Oh, I'm sure. I'm sure.
And that also, I think that points to some of what, it does help me answer that previous question, is what about you allowed you to make those connections? And if you are worried very much about the pronunciation of just one word, that gives a sense of how detail-oriented you were. And I think also your description of what you, of dressing up, of looking, as you said, debonair, right? And
yes.
Of being able to have that background, the class background that allowed you to potentially make an appeal that those who are actually from Galicia, directly from Galicia, who are straight out of the shtetl, would not have been able to do because they were not accustomed to dressing that way. They didn't have that sort of background. They didn't have the experience. And I wonder to what extent that your mother's essentially focus on class was also very critical and useful in getting you to safety. I'm sure that's
could
part
have been,
of
it. I don't know.
The part of the story is looking like you should be able to go is often part of the survival story.
I was an officer without being one, you mean?
Yes. You knew how to display authority. Yes.
That's fairly true.
So, I know we just mentioned the American consular officer who helped you, but were there other people that you came across in any of your experiences once you, even before you fled from Vienna, that you recall as particularly kind and helpful?
Well, the first and most important was a school teacher in Poe. I mentioned that, I'm sure, in my book.
A school teacher in Poe?
Yeah. PAU.
Mm-hmm.
Who took, when we got to Poe together with hundreds of thousands of refugees escaping from Paris, they opened the schools to, and we found ourselves in a classroom.
Even when the law didn't prohibit it.
Well, what were they going to do? They leave us on the street? There were hundreds of thousands of people who had escaped. Before, from the head of the German troop. Anyway, the school teacher saw the four of us sitting in desolation in a classroom, and he took us to his home.
Mm-hmm.
And he let us sleep on the couch in his living room. Mm-hmm.
Was it just you, or was it also your sister?
I'm sorry?
Was it just you or also your sister?
All four of us.
All four of you, yeah.
We managed to be in a civilized apartment for two or three nights.
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember how many until we found a truck that promised to take us to Marseille.
Mm-hmm. And do you have other recollections of other individuals like that?
There was an employee of the American consulate who had worked for the police, and we bribed him for access, but he was very pleasant in accepting the bribe.
Were there individuals you remember that were particularly vindictive or evil, or treated you poorly? In your experience as...
Not anybody who didn't do what I expected them to do. Mm. I mean, when I got splashed with a bag of ink in front of our apartment building in Nice.
Someone threw ink at you?
I didn't describe that in the book.
That one I don't recall. You probably did, but I don't remember that one.
I was, we had a furnished apartment in Nice, 12 Rue d'Alfonso. And on the same street, a few blocks further up, was the headquarters of the milicien. You know what the milice was. And they knew who we were. I mean, it was a small area. And one day when I came in, out of the apartment, a bag of ink was thrown at me, which broke, of course, and splashed ink all over me. And I went back upstairs and rushed off. What are you going to do?
Well, you mentioned one example of when you were in France, of actually a student, I think, calling you a dirty Jew, and you getting after him for it, going and beating him up.
I attempted to.
You attempted to? And yes. What happened?
We were broken up by a teacher.
And
when I started to go to school in Paris, and I didn't speak French much, but I could understand when somebody said "sale juif." And in Vienna, I wouldn't have been able to do anything.
Right.
But in Paris, at that time, I could. So I attacked him.
Do you remember how you were reproached by the teacher, or if you were reproached?
I was not reproached. They just separated us. I wouldn't have understood anything that was said to me anyway.
So you also talk about how you have a propensity for languages, and that basically French just started coming to you eventually.
I sat in class until and then one day suddenly I started to understand. And I read a lot. I can read a book in Spanish. I can't speak Spanish very well. I could communicate, but I have read Spanish books.
And your father, you said, also had the ability to communicate with people even when he couldn't speak the same language as they.
I remember that very well.
And so, how did that skill ever reappear in your military experience?
I felt confident about what I was being able to do.
I'm sorry?
I felt confident that I could handle myself.
Did you also feel confident in your ability to learn quickly because of the...
I never thought of that.
You never thought about it?
I learned when I read something, I retain it.
So, when we get to talk about Camp Ritchie, the recollections of a lot of other individuals who went through the camp was that it was a very rigorous curriculum.
I don't think it was rigorous at all.
You don't?
What was rigorous was the obstacle course, the physical training I didn't like. I'm a lazy person. I don't like to hop around.
Well, the fact that you are still hopping at 97 is pretty impressive, so I wouldn't call that lazy.
But
so when you arrived in the United States, you already could read English, or
I could read English very well, because Nice was a headquarters for the English vacationers before World War II, and so there were books around. English books. I read P.G. Woodhouse, I read Kipling,
wow.
I read all kinds of books, whatever I could read, either in French or in English.
And so when you arrived, did you start directly in school?
Yeah. I worked during the day, and I went to New York Evening School. Lincoln High School, which was where Lincoln Center now stands.
And when you were, we'll jump quickly to going from that to joining the army. So you were drafted and explained.
No, I was not. I volunteered.
You volunteered.
On my birthday, on my 18th birthday.
As soon as you could, right. So how did you find yourself at Camp Ritchie? Could you explain that?
I volunteered on September 4th, 1942, but I didn't get called up until early spring of 1943. Mm-hmm. And then I remember reporting for duty at Grand Central Station, mm-hmm. and being taken to Fort Dix, New Jersey, where we were given uniforms and facilities to pack up our civilian clothes and send them back to our home.
And when you joined, why did you join?
It was my war, and mm-hmm. I was so eager to go and fight against the Germans, mm-hmm. for my new country, mm-hmm. and for myself and for my family. Mm-hmm.
Did you feel you had to prove your citizenship?
No, mm-hmm. I had to. I just wanted to get into action against Germans in mm-hmm. the best way I could. But you asked about Fort Dix, New Jersey.
Yeah.
Where I was given civilian uniforms, mm-hmm. and we given some tests. And from there I was sent, you know, now I know that non-citizens at that time were not permitted to carry guns. Mm-hmm. I know that now, I didn't know it then. I know that they sent me to Camp Pickett, Virginia to be trained as a medic. Yeah. Well, what choices
really,
did
even
I?
Even in 1943?
Yes.
Well, in 1942, they had passed an act essentially allowing you to become the national security, or national security, I'm trying to remember the name of the act, but in theory,
what did I know?
Yeah,
I only found out now that that was the rule, but it may not have been applying to me. They may mm-hmm. just, what do I know? They may just have sent me to medics, I spent 3 weeks in basic trainings, mm-hmm. which was the only basic training I had. The basic training was supposed to be, I think, either 12 weeks or 9 weeks, I don't know.
Yeah, normal.
But I spent 3 weeks in mm-hmm. basic training, and during that time some more tests were taken, including language tests. Mm-hmm. I remember one where they said, write an autobiography in all the languages you can, so I started to write in German and in French and in English. Mm-hmm. About how I got to be where I was.
Mm-hmm. And do you recall any
And from there I was sent to Ritchie. Mm-hmm.
So, yes, yeah, so clearly the different tests, the language ability, probably something
The IQ test mm-hmm. Apparently was very crucial. And I remember the number. It was either 148 or 152. I don't know.
Either is quite high. So that's one thing, obviously, that you share with the others who went through Camp Ritchie, is that they were specifically chosen for intelligence. And one of
all, incidentally, an interesting sideline, mm-hmm. of all the people I met in the Austrian Jewish group that I mentioned, not one of them went to Ritchie except for me.
No.
And they were all the boys were in the service. Mm-hmm. They were all either drafted or volunteered.
Interesting. Very.
But none of them, which is interesting.
Oh yeah, I mean, it was quite selective. So the, in your experience when you joined the Army, when you had basic training, and even once you got to Camp Ritchie, did you experience or did you see forms of prejudice within the U.S. Army?
I did not. But then I must tell you, thinking backwards, it may be that I didn't recognize it. I was not unaccustomed to being discriminated against as a Jew. So it was nothing new to me.
Did people make comments about your accent?
Not the Ritchie, everybody had the accent.
Everyone. You've already answered, but do you remember any form of your experience at Camp Ritchie? Did it change what you thought about America? Or what was American?
I don't think so.
So in your mind, you had a vision of America as this nation of immigrants that you saw at Camp Ritchie?
Yes.
And what about the different groups of Americans that you may have interacted with there? So there was the African American.
I didn't know any African Americans, and I hardly saw any.
What about did you interact with the Italian prisoners of war?
I don't recall any Italian prisoners of war or German prisoners of war at Ritchie. I don't remember that there were any.
Do you recall the Native Americans who were the...
No.
The CSU?
I don't recall them at all. I remember only people who spoke, came of German or Austrian background, except for
do you recall class emerging as an issue among the people at Camp Ritchie?
Class?
Yeah, was there a difference between Jewish refugees who might have come from a poorer background versus Jewish refugees who came from a intellectual upper
class? I think essentially all the people I interacted with who were students at Ritchie, were of a reasonably intellectual background. There was something else I was going to tell you. Oh. It'll come to me.
Okay. So, how would you characterize the camp? Was the camp...
Oh, now it occurs to me. The only non-German speaking student at Ritchie was Ib Melchior, the son of Lawrence Melchior, who was a very famous opera singer. And Ib kept complaining that he speaks Danish and he shouldn't be here where they only speak German. He wanted to be transferred to the British Army, who controlled the northern hemisphere.
So interesting. So, and that actually helps you give me some ideas about this associated question. How would you describe the camp? Was it American or was it European?
Oh, the camp was American. It was run very strictly by the army.
That I understand, right? But the nature, the culture of the camp, was it European? Were there people, as you said, almost everyone is a German speaker in the class that you were in. The idea that you should just transfer to the British Army, I'm not sure that there were many American-born draftees that would have said, that's an option for me, that's something I want.
Well, the question didn't arise in my case. I was an American even long before I became a citizen. I was an American the moment I touched ground.
And what do you think made you that? What is it that you think of when you call yourself American?
I'm devoted to this country. I got a chance to make a decent life. After the war, I was totally penniless. And I live on the Upper East Side in considerable comfort. And I have three wonderful grandchildren and children and 11 grandchildren.
I know I'm pushing on this just so I can better understand and what I'm trying to do in my research is to get a sense of what people thought of as American. Those are things that all came in.
My quintessential American was Gary Cooper.
Your what?
My quintessential American was Gary Cooper. You remember?
Yes. Gary Cooper, the movie star.
Yes.
Yes. So was that who you, when you thought of what an American was? And was that? And
Ronald Coleman was my quintessential Britisher.
Yes. So, and had that come from actually seeing movies while you were even back in Vienna?
Yes.
And so, again, I know this is a hard question, and the things that you mentioned about being American were all things that came after the war.
Yes.
So when you say, as soon as you touched here, you thought of yourself as American, what was it that made you think of being American before all those other things happened? The debt you owe, or that you just described to a country that allowed you to do these things is one thing, but that debt had not been accrued yet.
Yes, it was. The fact that we were around and we could, once we landed and were permitted to land in the United States, we were allowed to do whatever we wanted to do to survive. And there was no government interference with that, which was unique. You didn't have to have a permit to do whatever you wanted to do. We were not afraid of work. I've told you about my parents with the hairnets, didn't I?
About your parents?
With the hairnets?
I think that was the first job that they had when they came and they were making, is that right?
I'm sorry.
Do you need to move? I'm more than happy to.
No, that's all right. I just want to push a little. My parents and my sister and I, when we had time. Filled envelopes with hairnets that were sold at Woolworth. And they got paid for so and so much for each 1,000 envelopes. And that was in addition to my father trying to get back into business. That was at home. And I had a job as a shipping clerk, physical labor. And left the house in the morning, worked my 8-hour job working for a costume jewelry firm, and then went straight to class at the New York Evening High School and came home at 10 in the evening or 11 in the evening.
And was that kind of life similar in a way to, other than the work during the day as opposed to school?
That was totally different from the way life was in Vienna.
In terms of the class, but I'm thinking more in terms of social life. Did you have time?
I had no time for social life at all during
the
week.
That element was similar in that you were very devoted to just doing the things you needed to do. 24 hours a day. So enough work to survive in school in order to have schooling. And
what did never occur to me, not I have a master's degree from Columbia that I took on the GI Bill of Rights after the war. And I did it at night because it was there and the government paid for it. And somebody had told me that during the Depression, you had to have a master's degree to get a job at Macy's.
And so, yes, so you took the initiative. So
but I got it at night.
Yeah. So when you, was that process a process that also got you acquainted with other sets of people who were going through something similar? In terms of becoming American,
none of us talked about our experiences. And that was one of the good things about that group of Austrian Jews. Nobody talked about how they got to the United States. Everybody had a story, and we didn't discuss it. Our story was probably longer than most people because it took us 3 years. But everybody had a story, and we didn't want to know about it. And then during the war, we were all soldiers. All the boys were soldiers. And we also understood that it wasn't up to the individual where he served. You had no control over that. I was could have just as easily have been sent to the South Pacific. Which would not have been what I wanted, but that, once you're in the army, you do what you're told.
Mm-hmm. So was there something about your experience in the army? I mean, you describe a little of, in your book, you describe the, a little bit about the experience of being a soldier in the Austro-Hungarian Empire.
That was my father.
Right. But you also then, this is a question I forgot to ask about history, but I'll put that aside. Was there something that you saw that was different about the way the U.S. Army made soldiers?
How would I know what the difference is?
Well, because you also studied the other armies, right? Did you feel that there was something that that brought people together in the way that the U.S. Army prepared you or didn't prepare you for war?
I don't know. I had no other experiences except...
Except what these were. Okay. So, but you do describe, and you've told me this in a conversation before, about how you ran into your professor, your rabbi, at Camp Ritchie, also peeling potatoes.
Yes. Right?
And so... That, in a way, that's kind of where I was leading, is that, is there something different, and perhaps it is a class element, where there's less sense of class, or was there less sense of class in the U.S. Army than that which you saw in other armies? And that class difference, even though I remember you very specifically telling me that while we were both privates, I could not refer to him as a private. It was still a professor or a rabbi.
That's correct.
So that idea of status or that idea of class...
Well, let me tell you, I think this will tell you something. After the war, after I came home, after I had done some other jobs, I had a job for... and I was going to school at night, but during the day I was floundering, looking for something to do. And I got a job as an import-export trainee for a firm called A. Naaman at 82 Beaver Street in the Wall Street area, which was an import-export firm. And I was the lowest man on the totem pole. There were 30 or 40 employees. There was a general manager, And for some reason or another, he and I went out to lunch together periodically. He was 20 years older than me and married, and he was a general manager, and I was his equal, and we had, and I think that made a difference. I was an officer without being an officer, if you know what I'm saying.
In the company.
In the company, I was the lowest man at the totem pole. But it was as if I had been in the army when I was a private and went out for lunch with a colonel.
But it was...
But I could do that. I was an officer without being an officer.
And why do you think, was that something that you equate with being American, or is that something
No,
you
that
equate
is
with being
after my experiences. I had the authority, even though I didn't have the authority.
And that authority, you think, came from your
experience as a refugee in France, where I had to, at the age of 15 and 16, maneuver my way around.
So what we today call street wisdom. Right.
What is the word?
Street wisdom, right? The idea of learning from the streets and learning having that non-book experience in a way.
But still, at the same time, the authority. Mm-hmm. When I was that I could talk to people, and they treated me as if I were their boss.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, I'd love to know where that comes from. And it may not be answerable, but how do people develop that kind of innate sense of authority, which I think you certainly have. And when I first met you, I noticed it right away. To be honest with you, even within your... I think when we first met, you were still in your late 80s.
I was a young man.
A young man. Was there anything that you would call Jewish about Camp Ritchie?
Most of the students were Jewish. Mm-hmm.
Did that impact the camp in any way? Was there...
No, I don't think it's so... I don't think it had anything to do with it. We had, there were certainly no observances of Shabbat or of any, nothing of the kind.
Not an 8-day week, right?
No, no. The only thing I can say is that when we were in Fort Hamilton, Brooklyn, waiting for embarkation on a troop transport to Europe, and we did, a few of us went to the chaplain, the Jewish chaplain, and he said a broche over us. There seems to be a broche for everything. It didn't hurt. I came back safe and sound. I'm not sure whether that applied to everybody who was there at the time, because I didn't keep up with them.
So, now, I know when, after we did the talk with these folks, you told me that you had a story about Camp Sharp that you wanted to
tell. I didn't have a story, except that I said what I want to tell you is that...
Maybe we need to wait again. Sorry. Do you want something to drink? Do you want some water?
No, I had coffee from you. Okay. How much longer do you think you need?
Whatever you want. I can stop at any time. For me, we can always have another conversation.
We can do that any time. I think we ought to have lunch.
Okay. So we'll have you answer this last question,
and then
we'll have lunch. Okay. So you said that you didn't have a story about Camp Sharp, but you had...
Except that it was... We failed.
That you failed?
No, we failed.
Oh.
Those of us who were sent to Camp Sharp. felt, because we were never told anything. We were just sent there.
Mm-hmm.
It was a miserable, cold, cold, cold place. We did nothing. We hiked around the battlefield of Gettysburg, and I had no idea how important the Battle of Gettysburg was.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know enough about American history. I didn't know anything about the Civil War. But we hiked around it without explanation. I remember being on guard duty in the middle of the night and being cold as I've never been in my life. It was a miserable place. There was no education, there was no information. We were just discarded after having spent 4 or 5 months or 6 months being trained in all these sophisticated.
So you did not do work with?
There was no work, there was no education, there was no study.
Was this all when they were actually creating the curriculum for Camp Sharp?
I have no idea what they were doing.
So you just did guard duty and
hiking around the battlefield.
Mm-hmm. And all during the winter. Now, do you think there's very little, I think, that can prepare anyone for actual battle or for something like the Battle of the Bulge?
Camp Sharp didn't do anything.
But do you think that this experience did help?
No, it didn't.
No, it didn't help anything.
A miserable experience with no justification.
Mm-hmm. Did you ever take courses at Camp Sharp?
No.
Okay, so you were then
nothing
sent
at Camp Sharp except hike around the battlefield.
So then they deployed you from Camp Sharp to London?
No, to first to Fort Hamilton, Brooklyn.
Oh, okay. And what did you do there?
We waited.
Okay. And then you were sent to.
I went home every night. I got a pass every second night, and I could buy a pass for my fellows easily for me. So I took the subway as soon as I was permitted.
You went home?
I went home, and my mother made dinner, and they were happy to see me.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes I went out with my sister, and then I got up at 5 in the morning so I could be at camp. Sharp at 8 in the morning at camp.
Wow. So I'll ask one last question.
Next evening I was home again, and my parents, who had to make sure that there was food at the house, that I got up at 5 in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure that finally they kept saying, go already.
Go already. Now, do you think, do you remember anything about being, was there a pride in you serving? Was there, were your parents at that point part of a community where they say, here's my son?
I don't know. I don't know anything about their social life.
Interesting.
They were certainly unhappy that I was in the army.
They were unhappy.
They were parents.
Yes, of course.
How would you feel if your daughter?
I know exactly what you're saying, especially because they knew you would go to war.
Yes.
Yes. So, okay. Good. Did your mother still believe that you were going to become a doctor?
No.
Not by that point.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Well, on that note, we should stop and give you, this is Max, thank you so much for a lot of time. And I know this can get very tiring. So thank you for doing that. And well, I'm sure there's more discussion to be had. Hopefully we learned a little bit.
I'd be happy to answer any questions, but I think we should have lunch.
Yes, let's do that. And thank you.
Thank you.
Again, don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll some sunny day. Keep smiling through, just like you always do, till the blue skies drive the dark clouds far away. So will you please say hello to the folks that I know? Tell them I won't be long. They'll be happy to know that as you saw me go, I was singing this song. We'll meet again, don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day.
We'll meet again, don't know when. Oh.